George Bernard Shaw, the Irish dramatist, once said, I quote, "Progress is impossible without change, and those who cannot change their minds cannot change anything." When Shaw died, our next speaker was not born, but his definition, or his quotation defines pretty well what our next speaker will talk about. You will now hear a world-renowned speaker who offers new thinking for those who wish to benefit from a changed mindset. His accomplishments include Ministry of Science commercial strategy, launching an Sky TV channel, creating Ogilvy's mobile strategy worldwide, and becoming the youngest ever chairman of the British Music Industries Association. He's mastermind and book author in several areas, one book titled Digital Revolution. But his personal mantra is change. Companies like Google, Apple, Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Nestle, and IKEA listen to him. This morning, today, we listen to Jonathan MacDonald. A warm welcome, Jonathan.
There's an amazing Chinese proverb that says that when the winds of change are blowing, some build a wall and others build a windmill. I want you to consider this for a second. When the winds of change are blowing, some build a wall, imagine a wall. Others build a windmill. What does that mean? Think about what that means. Think about when we've experienced or you've experienced change that's happened. Think about it in your life. Can you remember a time when you felt something was changing around you? Maybe it was a change in your children growing up. Anyone here with teenage children will know exactly what I mean. Maybe there was a change in your work. Maybe there was a change in society in general. Do you remember your reaction? Were you a wall? Did you create a wall inside yourself and hope that the change would pass? Or did you take the winds of change and construct a windmill that is powered by the change? Because, you see, the thing is that change happens anyway. There isn't a wall big enough to stop change. There isn't a wall strong enough to reverse the force of change. And what's more, is that today is the slowest pace of change we'll ever experience. I want to say that again. Today is the slowest pace of change we will ever experience. We have an enormous opportunity to construct a window that does not hope that change passes, that uses the change as our power, that embraces the change as a fuel, that structures itself to work with change, not against it. The reactions of a wall, and we've all been there, believe me, I'm resistant to change as much as anyone else. Predominantly, however, I'm willing to try and build a windmill because I have two young children and I'm concerned what their lives look like in 20, 30, 40, 50 years' time. But these wall buildings, these aren't logical. If we pride ourselves on being logical, rational, educated people, then these walls are not logical. The only logic when it comes to change? Is that the change that we make within ourselves, in our cities, in our plans, in our strategies, in our governments, the only logical truth is that the change has to cost the same or less than the benefit, or the cost of not doing so. That is the only logical response to change on Earth. There is no logical response being a war. Today is the slowest pace of change we'll ever experience. Change is perpetual and happens anyway. If you build a wall, you cannot actually grow because the wall is static and change is fluid. The only logical response, and the reason to build a windmill, if you can use this maybe when you're trying to convince the people around you that maybe we should make a change, argue it in a point of logic then. It's all awkward, it's hard to argue emotionally, because it's totally subjective. What my version of good is different from your version of good. What my version of necessary is different from your version of necessary. Are carbon emissions more or less important than water pollutants? This is emotional stuff, okay? Logically, the change has to cost the same or less than the benefit, or the cost of not doing so. There is no other answer to change. This isn't an emotional keynote. This is a statement of absolute fact. Now, where do we go in terms of inspiration? I know we can think about the brilliant works of Aristotle Politics, let's say. It speaks about the purpose of a city. The purpose of a city to enable happiness and for people to find their own purpose. It's called telenics, by the way. The study of purpose. The purpose of a knife is to cut. The purpose of a shoe is to cushion. We all have a purpose. What is our telos? Well, it was said that cities are actually meant to enable us to find our purpose and be happy. Does it sound outdated? Not to this guy, who 24, 48 hours ago actually wrote pretty much the new version of Aristotle's Politics. He's building a windmill. We can go back to the Turkish caves. Okay, from Mesopotamia to now Turkey as we know it, and the infrastructure of things that happen not necessarily on the ground, but underground. And if you flip that open, you could also see up in the air and in space. We can look at what happens with Eindhoven's cycling innovations. We can look at what happens in Medellin's cable car innovations. We can look at what happens in Mecca. Inspiration is everywhere, but that is only inspiration. It is not action. The difference between knowing and doing is the difference between building a wall and building a window. And what's more so, is that there are things that are happening now that we will learn about over the next day or two. With great speakers, speaking of such things as sustainable living enterprises, or vertical farming, or electrification of transport. It's brilliant. It's great. Let's not be fooled that knowing about it is the same as doing it. Nothing will change if we know about it. Things require action. And the more we look around, the more we look at things like biospheres or things that happen in major blockbuster movies or, you know, even people who are living off-grid in totally sustainable pods. Their inspiration for us is everywhere, but we have to think also about outside of our comfort area, looking at the winds of change that are somewhat different. The winds of change that are actually involving drones. Where will they land? How will they be regulated? What's it mean to logistics companies? What about in the legal world? Now Facebook and LinkedIn now using AI business lawyer, where are the lawyers going to be housed without jobs? When we have an increasing population, longer age rates, longer lifespan, fewer resources, and technology added to it, let's not be so certain that we know everything. What will happen to these people? These are all the winds of change, by the way. This is the winds of change. He's seen enough. My lawyer is now leaving. I'm sorry to hear. It's amazing to think that some companies, and I don't wish to name any names, some companies are really, really keen on us losing the very thing that makes us human. Yes, we have environmental challenges. Yes, we have technological capabilities that are fascinating. But we also, at the core, have a fundamental question as to what is life now and moving forward. I'm tempted to think that this ultra technical 2.0, 3.0 augmented virtual hyper-reality may return back on itself, and maybe we'll see the return of actual humanity. Maybe we will go so far down the line of technology that we end up valuing the very thing that makes us human. Maybe the point of Urban Futures Conference and projects moving forward is not just to transition into sustainable ways of living, but also to transition into sustainable human life. There is no point in having sustainability if we do not have humanity. These are the winds of change that are blowing. We can either build a wall, or we can build a windmill. It all depends on the lens that we view this through. Now, in my job, I spend 2-3 days a week traveling the world doing this. I've done for many, many years. I've been lucky enough to help large companies and small companies, some of which you may know, change the way that they think and expand their mindset. Not in a motivational speaker way, not kind of like, let's walk across hot coals, you can do it. I'm talking about ways that actually matter, and I actually convert into action. So what I have to do is I have to scan thousands of posts and blogs and articles every single day. And what I thought I'd do, because I don't have very much time on stage today, what I thought I'd do is I'd collect all of my news sources and put them all on one slide. And on the same slide, give a download link so you can download the entire deck free of charge. Would that be of interest? Would that be of value? So if I give you all of my entire news sources, yeah? Okay, everyone get your camera phone now. Now, for those older people in the room, the thing that you've got in your pocket that you call your kids with, that has a camera. So pull that out of your, that's a joke. Pull it out of your pocket. No? You don't want all the news sources that you need to be monitoring, but you're not interested in that. Maybe get your pen out. Remember pens? Piece of paper. Yeah, good. I see a notepad. A proud notepad in the end. Remember then, our kids won't have a clue what they look like. Good. So, this is the link. There's no fee. It's just a link, a video of me running through everything I scan, all the pieces of information I scan. And you can download the deck, you can then copy and paste the deck and use it as your own. I don't mind, it's yours. Spreading the seeds. Anything that means that my kids are actually able to live happily for 30, 40, 50 years, I'm okay with that. You see, the thing is, I believe in terms of knowledge that there's 1% of stuff we know we know, there's 1% of stuff we know we don't know, and there's 98% of stuff we don't know we don't know. So if nothing else, take the link. Or not. You see, the thing is that we as a populace, we as a people, suffer significantly from business poison. Business poison is things like knowing what we need to do, but actually thinking that it's too much effort. Knowing what the right thing is, but knowing that that would get us kicked out of office. Knowing that we've got enough money so we don't need to change, even though we think we probably should. These are business poisons and life poisons. And there's another set of poisons that we have, and that's sometimes the structure of organisations. See if you recognise anyone on this chart. Yeah, that's not a good thing, huh? Especially not if it's you. I actually met a guy from a mobile network that I won't name. He introduced himself as the VP of No. I was like, nice to meet you. This is going to be a fun meeting. We have this challenge, right? What about if we want to build a windmill? We don't want to build a wall, but our windmill is going to be surrounded by walls. Bear in mind that one thing we can't affect is change. One thing we can affect is the people that we surround ourselves with. What I do, what I've realised, is that there's only one way of getting around this kind of problem. And that is to find the people who are the stars in an organisation or a council, whatever it is, and work with them. I run these retreats called Unlock Sessions. The Unlock Sessions are 3-day retreats all over the world. We fast track all this kind of stuff through, but I'm not here to sell my services. This is just for people who want an unfair competitive advantage. The key part, oh, sorry, there was someone taking a picture. You can take a picture. The point of this is, if you're in a situation where there's a wall, maybe the wall's inside you, or maybe the wall is your boss, maybe the wall is your staff. I would like you to just remember one grid. This is the grid. I've been in business for 25 years, believe it or not. I've had 7 startup companies myself, 3 of which worked, 4 of which were massive disasters. I've advised over 225 companies in 119 cities, 3 of which took my advice. This grid is what I wish I knew when I was younger. When you're in the business of trying to build a window, it is vitally important to assess everyone around you on this grid. Do they have will or no will? Do they have skill or no skill? That's it. The people with no will and no skill, I assume you've either left your job, moved companies, moved offices, moved countries, fired the staff, whatever it is, right? Assuming the bottom right-hand corner is out. That's not very common. People with no will and no skill, we probably wouldn't have any of them in this room today. But then the question is, what about if you have no will, but you have skill? What about if you could do something, you just can't be bored? Very popular. What's amazing about that is that it is an opportunity to work out how to transfer that skill into someone with the will or to find the will in them. You know what I've realised about finding the will in people? We are on the top right-hand side at the moment, so we've done the bottom right-hand side. On the top right-hand side, okay? I've realised that those people who can't be bothered have built a wall, and there's a reason why they've built a wall. What is that reason? Is it because the change looks like it's going to cost more than the benefit? Do you remember that logic? Is it that they haven't worked out the cost of not doing it? I rarely see people doing a cost-benefit analysis strongly on the cost of not doing it. People looking at cost-benefit analysis in terms of the cost of doing it. I'm interested in the cost-benefit analysis or the cost-risk analysis of not doing it. And Lord have mercy, should we have listened to that about climate change 30 years ago. The people who have built a wall on the top right-hand side of this graph have built the wall because they think that the change is going to cost more than the benefit, or they have not worked out the cost of not doing it. That, my friends, is that. Once you've got round the emotional thing of, I just don't want to change, or it just feels too hard, the actual genesis of that wall, the brick of the wall, is a brick of not seeing the change as more beneficial than the cost, or not calculating the cost of not doing it. Do you see what I mean? They have not worked out that equation. Ultimately, logically, they have not. Because if they did work out that equation, then they are essentially opting to give up. On the left-hand side, what about if we have people with no skill, but loads of will? No problem. These people. That's me, it's not me, Mum. I'm actually good at writing. The thing is, in the bottom left-hand side, these people can be taught. These people can learn. These people can be trained. These people can be inspired. These people have potential. In fact, these people should take the skill from the people in the top right. Maybe you put the people in the top right into some form of system to extract all of their skills so we can transfer it. Not scientifically, mind. I mean through conversation. And on the top left, if we have people with the will and we have people with the skill, then we have the leaders. Actually, it doesn't matter about the skill. It matters mostly about the will. The leaders are in the top left. The learners are in the bottom left. Leaders, learners. This is windmill territory. Just before I finish that point and finish my deck for the day, I want to just give you my email address because I've only got 3 business cards. I stopped getting business cards printed about 2 years ago. It's a massive waste of resources. Don't bother. We've got these technologies. Just share information some other way. I worked out that out of the 250 million business people in corporate enterprise around the world, we probably have somewhere on average of 1 trillion or so business cards. So, here's my email address. It's sustainable. I have got 3 or 4 cards if you have to have a piece of paper. But please take this. It's j@10.io. Get in touch if you like. I don't. If you want any more information or whatever, it's fine. Sorry? I reply to emails normally within an hour. I check my emails, but no one actually bothers emailing me. So I speak in front of about 70,000 people each month on stage, and I've had about 4 emails in the last 2 weeks, so my risk is low. I'm not like a mayor, you know, this isn't, I haven't got a serious problem. Or benefit. But my final point of the day really is, if you remember nothing else from my talk, I want you to remember that when the winds are changing, some build a wall and some build a windmill. And the solution to this paradox is to find those with the will to change. Because, my friends, with the will to change we will. Thank you.